The next item of business is a debate on motion 2922 in the name of Fergus Ewing on sea fisheries and end-year negotiations. I can ask members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. I call on Fergus Ewing, Cabinet Secretary, to speak and move the motion. 13 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, it's a great privilege to have the opportunity to speak up for the Scottish fishing industry in this debate. And in doing so, I'm very cognizant of the fact that I'm succeeding Richard Lockhead, who was a champion of the Scottish fishing industry for a great many years. And I'm very pleased that we're joined in the gallery today by distinguished leaders of the Scottish fishing sector, Michael Bates of Scottish Seafood and Bertie Armstrong, of the leader of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation. Presiding Officer, Scotland's fishermen are held in great regard across our country. Colleagues across all parties look to this proud industry as the embodiment of the very best of our country. And that's why I was honoured to be asked by the First Minister to become the Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for fishing. And in that role, I will do everything that I can to help the rural economy grow and create prosperity. And naturally, that includes the fishing industry, which is an integral component of the weft and weave of many of our rural communities, including the great port of Peterhead, which I was pleased to visit the fish market early on Monday this week. And I was delighted to see that the catch by tonnage was at record levels, a tribute to all involved. So it's important that we take the time in this chamber to acknowledge the importance of the autumn quota negotiations for the fortunes of the Scottish industry. Presiding Officer, let me summarise where we've got to in the negotiations process this year. We now have a full set of scientific advice from ICES. Overall, it paints a reasonably positive picture for 2017, with increases advised for a range of stocks such as saithe, hake, monkfish, North Sea Norway lobster, rockall haddock, mackerel, blue whiting, and Atlanto Scandian herring. But as usual, there are other stocks where the advice is more difficult. In the West, the fortunes of cod, whiting, and herring remain stubbornly intractable, whilst in the North Sea, there are cuts advised for haddock, herring, cod, and whiting. For the latter two, cod and whiting, the cuts are particularly challenging, given that they are being phased into the landing obligation in 2017, when reductions in quota will increase the risk of choking the mixed fishery. I should underline the Scottish Government remains committed to the ambition of elimination of discards, but in implementing the discard ban, we must also tackle the challenge of choke species. We must protect the livelihoods of our fishermen, and we must prevent a situation where our fleet is unnecessarily tied to the quayside where there is still quota available to fish. We are working hard to address these challenges, and we are playing an active role in the regional groups in which we have an interest to drive forward the development of innovative policy solutions to choke risks. We should not be afraid to be radical where the situation calls for it. I raised this very issue with other fisheries ministers at the November Council in Brussels. In addition, following the effective end of the cod recovery plan, and an end which I shed no tears, I welcome that cod days at sea will be a thing of the past. This should help the fleet adapt to the landing obligation by providing the scope to move to different grounds to control catches of certain stocks. Yes, of course.
John Scott.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. And would he consider agreeing with me that one of the ways of catching for the market and catching in terms of the quota that's there that's unused would be a more collaborative approach between our fishermen working in real time in terms of the data that they have available to them and the quotas that are available, and that it might be something worth pursuing in future in terms of reducing discards as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, yes, I do agree with Mr. Scott that there are a great many measures in which the choke problem can be ameliorated. Quota swaps are one method of doing that. Inter-area swaps are another method of doing that. Flexibility and measures of flexibility are an additional way of doing that. Measures which control effort or are designed to limit effort, and measures which enable smaller fish to escape. These are all kind of a combination of measures which are required. But I'm very pleased the member has raised it because it's given me the opportunity to agree with Mr. Scott and others who rightly raised this as possibly the most serious issue that faces the industry at the moment in relation to the common fisheries policy. So I'm grateful to Mr. Scott for doing that. And if I can find my place, I'll revert at this point to the script. Yes, so returning to the autumn negotiations, they will also have a critical role to play by making available in 2017 additional quota top-ups to cover catches of fish that were previously discarded but will now have to be landed. Of course, what stands between the scientific advice and the final quota for next year are the negotiations themselves, where balances and compromises sometimes need to be found. This year's talks are now well underway and have already delivered some strong results. The coastal states talks for mackerel took place in October and delivered an excellent 14% increase for 2017. At current prices, this equates to a value of around £218 million for Scotland, an increase of around £28 million on 2016. However, the coastal states talks on blue whiting and Atlanto-Scandian herring have been less satisfactory. Whilst they agree total catches for 2017, they failed to agree each party's share of this. So uncoordinated and unilateral quota are inevitable and risk continued overfishing this important and valuable stock. Last week's negotiations between the EU and Norway delivered a pair of important agreements. On the one hand, an agreement was signed which ring-fenced shares and access arrangements for blue whiting and Atlanto-Scandian herring in 2017. Now, whilst I'm pleased this will prevent a repeat of the inexcusably opaque events we saw at last year's December Council, disappointingly, this agreement also increased the level of Norwegian access to our waters next year, access that Scotland has to bear the burden of policing. Conclusion of the parallel whitefish agreement then followed late last Friday evening. This brings certainty on quota levels for some of our key North Sea stocks and allows fishing to begin on the 1st of January. I'm very pleased that this government's involvement in the negotiations successfully turned around proposed cuts in North Sea cod and whiting to deliver increases of around 17% for each. This respects the scientific advice and continues to move these stocks towards MSY fishing levels. But importantly, it provides a bit more time for the industry to adjust to the phasing of these stocks into the landing obligation next year. In addition, we secured a significant overall 53% increase in North Sea safe. Now, this will provide the best possible platform from which this stock will be phased into the landing obligation in the North Sea in 2018. However, alongside these positives, the new agreement contains some disappointments. In particular, my view is that the cost of the deal was excessive. The European Commission chose to give away to Norway some 110,000 tonnes of blue whiting, primarily a Scottish stock, with very little direct tangible benefit being returned to the Scottish fishing industry. As a result, I took the decision, fully supported by the UK government, to oppose the overall package on the table. However, the Commission chose to ignore the views of the second largest contributor to the package and signed the agreement anyway. Moving on, the EU Faroe talks are underway as I speak. In return for the essential quota and access opportunities to Faroese waters, this agreement provides for our whitefish fleet. Faroese vessels may fish a number of their quota in our waters, including mackerel. Whilst I accept this as part of the agreement, I cannot accept how the level of Faroese access was fixed in 2014, done by a private deal by the Commission without any consultation with Member States. However, I'm hearing today, Presiding Officer, from my officials, and this will be of interest in particular to Mr. Scott, I believe, I'm hearing today that at the ongoing EU Faroe talks in Brussels, that helpfully the issue of the level of Faroese access for mackerel is now back on the negotiating table rather than being fixed. Whilst it nevertheless will be very challenging to deliver a reduction from the existing 30%, this issue is now again being discussed in the negotiations, and that is a significant step forward. Finally, this year's negotiations reached their conclusion at next week's December Council, which I will attend, and which will negotiate the remaining stocks fished solely by EU fleets. My focus at the Council will be to ensure that good scientific advice is converted into actual quota to resist cuts where these are scientifically justifiable reasons for doing so, and to continue to secure other outcomes linked to tackling future choke risks. Of course, I can't talk about fisheries without referring to the result of the now not so recent European referendum. I acknowledge that many in the fishing industry voted to leave the EU, and I understand why that is the case. The Common Fisheries Policy, Presiding Officer, has not been a success for Scottish fisheries. And I recognise that there are opportunities outside of the EU for our industry. And I'm very pleased that we have worked very closely with Bertie Armstrong and his colleagues on all of these matters over the past months. And I fully intend to press the UK government to ensure that we make the most of these. Indeed, a few weeks ago, I wrote to Andrea Leadsom urging her to confirm that she would not give away permanent access to Scottish waters to European fishing vessels in any exit deal. For we must not give up control over our waters and give away access, our most valuable asset, on a permanent basis. Rather, we should negotiate access to our waters on an annual basis, as indeed do Norway, the Faroes, and Iceland. It would be totally unacceptable for the UK government to use access to our waters to solve problems with quota in English waters, as they seem to hint that they may wish to do. But we also acknowledge the risks that Brexit will bring and the potential damage it can do to the industry. In 2015, Scotland exported £438 million of seafood to the EU, and we benefited from 50 EU trade deals. This is why we must avoid a hard Brexit, and the UK should remain a full member of the single market. And it's also why it's so important that we get our fishing industry on the most sustainable footing now, so it's in the best place possible to cope with whatever the future brings. Presiding Officer, it's clear that the autumn negotiations are a complex process. This year they are taking place in an increasingly complex political landscape. What is simple, however, is my pledge to explore and seek to activate all options open to us to secure the best outcomes for our industry. I will work tirelessly to ensure that this year's talks deliver the best possible deals and have Scotland's best interests at their heart. And in conclusion, I look forward to listening very carefully to the amendments put forward by the other three main parties. And I want to say that I will listen with great care and with having in mind the clear desire in our fishing communities that this Parliament speak with one voice. So I hope that the opposition spokesmen are able to persuade me of their particular cause so that unity can emerge this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Cabinet Secretary, I ask you to move the motion, please. Thank you. I now call Peter Chapman to speak to and move amendment 2922.1. Mr. Chapman, 8 minutes are there, but with a little time in hand, so I can be a bit relaxed for a while with the times.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm always pleased when you say you're relaxed. I am particularly glad to be leading today's debate, as the impact of year-end negotiations is of huge importance to my constituents in the North East region. It is fair to say that the towns of Peterhead and Fraserburgh are the two towns in Britain most reliant on fishing and fish processing for their prosperity, and that over the years they have suffered as our fishing industry has declined. But before anyone accuses a buck and loon like me of being parochial, it is not just my corner of Scotland that will be watching these developments closely. They have an impact right across Scotland. One of the key factors behind the Scottish fishing industry's recent success is the willingness that our fishermen have shown in moving to more sustainable fishing methods. They have, time and time again, taken the tough decisions that have replenished our stocks of fish. But these decisions have come at a huge cost to these communities over the years, as boats have been scrapped and fishermen have had to find other jobs. There was a time when there was a great deal of fear over the future of cod stocks, and it was the determination of our industry to keep fishing sustainably that brought these stocks back up to the healthy level that we see them at today. Our fishermen have pioneered new technology, such as nets designed to allow younger fish to escape and the targeting of species. They have proved that they are innovative, forward-looking, and are leading the world in these new nets and techniques. And it is this ability to innovate that comes from an understanding of the need to protect a long-term resource that makes our fishing fleet the envy of the rest of Europe. And of course, there are still a great many challenges facing our fishing industry. To go back to cod, the extension of the discard ban to cod and whiting, if mishandled, could have a serious detrimental impact on a real success story of Scottish fishing. And this SNP government has a responsibility to make sure that Scottish fishermen are not unfairly penalised as the industry comes to grips with the landing obligation. Last week, just when all looked well and many of us were ready to celebrate a successful year-end negotiation, a last-minute intervention from Norway threw into sharp relief the disservice that the EU does to Scottish fishing. The EU traded away 110,000 tonnes of blue whiting to Norway, up from 75,000 tonnes last year. And these are fish that will be caught in UK waters and will have a direct negative impact on boats working out of Scotland. And they traded it in exchange for Arctic cod. The UK delegation voted against this deal, but of course we were outvoted. Now this cod will be of great interest to Portuguese, French and Dutch fishing crews, but totally useless for our industry because our fishermen don't fish there. Now post-Brexit, the UK will have far greater control over who fishes in our waters and the rules governing them. We will only trade away fish for other tonnage which our fishermen can catch and have a market for. And this is the sea of opportunity which Bertie Armstrong and his colleagues throughout the industry are so keen to see.
Would a member take an intervention?
Yeah.
Stuart Stevenson.
I know the member and I were both at the North East Fisheries Development Partnership, and I think there was broad agreement in the room that the red line in all negotiations should be that no decisions about foreign access to new fishing opportunities should precede our getting control of them. Does the member agree with that position that was expressed there?
Peter Chapman.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Post-Brexit, we will have that exact control, and that's what I've been emphasising in the last couple of minutes. I read with interest Fergus Ewing's comments in yesterday's P&J, where he was blaming the CFP for the last-minute Norway deal. Quite right. What I don't understand is how he squares that stance with his desire to keep the fishing industry subject to the CFP by us remaining in the EU. And he says he's worried about the UK government selling the fishing industry out in Brexit negotiations. But I would argue that it's this SNP government's policy that ignores and disrespects the desires of Scotland's fishermen. And if the SNP government position is that we should give away our quota for the benefit of other EU nations, then one has to wonder how they define standing up for Scotland. One more, yeah.
Kate Ford. Gail Ross.
Talking about definitions, maybe the member can explain what expendable means, because certainly that's what the Tories said that our fishing industry was in the 1970s.
Peter Chapman.
Well, you could well be right, Gail, Miss Ross, in that quote, because that was long before any of us were involved in this thing, and maybe that was correct at the time. But what we're doing now is looking forward to the opportunities that are coming down the road, not what happened 40 years ago. If the SNP government, no, where are we? Scottish fishermen see the future as one outside the EU, and the SNP position of staying tied to the EU, even at the cost of a second independence referendum, is seen as a complete betrayal by our fishermen. There was a time when the First Minister's predecessor, Alex Salmond, understood the anger and frustration that the CFP provoked, and his commitment then resulted in a bill to Parliament for the UK to leave the Common Fisheries Policy back in 2004. But Nicola Sturgeon now runs the SNP, and what she said on the CFP was equally clear. She said, and I quote, The reality is that it is essential to get rid of the CFP, which is disastrous for Scottish fishing. Well, I can't be the only one who is curious. What has changed? These mixed messages and support for a vital Scottish industry betrays the true objective of the SNP and its primary concern, which of course is separation. It doesn't matter how pressing an issue is, it doesn't matter how important it is to stand up for Scotland's key sectors, the only thing that matters is creating more grievance that allows the SNP to push for a second independence referendum. But I have to admit, I was shocked and angered when I heard Alex Salmond on national TV at the weekend gleefully saying that a constitutional crisis would be welcome. He was referring to the court case regarding the triggering of Article 50. But for any politician to welcome a constitutional crisis shows just how dangerous Salmond has become. He will sink to any levels to further his dream. It just goes to show that the SNP will say anything and do anything to achieve their dream of separation, no matter the cost to Scotland. Presiding officer, we have a great UK team fighting our corner in the year-end negotiations. The problem with these negotiations is that the EU has to work on behalf of 28 countries under majority voting. It is inevitable that the UK will not always win every fight around that table. And that is why, when industry leaders talk about the sea of opportunity that Brexit presents, I take them seriously. We will be a sovereign nation controlling some of the best fishing waters in the world. Our decisions and our trade-offs will be done with the UK's best interest at heart, not those of EU nations. And at the moment, nearly 60% of fish caught in our waters is caught by non-UK EU fishing boats. We have such a great opportunity to put our fishing industry first. Great strides have been made by our industry, but there is more that can be done once we have left the EU and the CFP. If only the SNP could see the opportunity Brexit brings to our fishermen and embrace it, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chapman. I call on Rhoda Grant to speak to and move amendment 2922.2. Ms. Grant, 7 minutes and a little bit.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate is as much an annual event as the negotiations that we are debating. If we were setting up such negotiations afresh, we wouldn't do it like this. And we might hope that if Brexit has one upside, it is this, that the annual negotiations surrounding quota and total allowable catches will not happen like this in the future. However, historic negotiations with Norway and the Faroes don't fill me with high expectations for that. Going forward, our fishing communities are clear that they want rights to UK waters. However, they will also need access to European markets, and those two things will require further negotiation, but that is for another day. We are still part of the EU, and these negotiations are just as important today as they have been in the past. Can I firstly turn to our amendment? Marine Scotland operate marine protection vessels, formerly the Scottish Fishery Protection Fleet. These are the people that ensure that the negotiations are adhered to, the negotiations we're talking about today. The work of these crews, the crews of these vessels are specialists, and they need an understanding of the fishing industry. Some years ago, Marine Scotland were having difficulty in recruiting and retaining crew, and therefore they paid a retention bonus of £5,000 to keep them within the service. Even with this bonus, their salaries were lower than those of other publicly paid seafarers. For instance, a chief steward for Marine Scotland earns up to £29,579 a year, while with CalMac, the same post is paid £37,675 a year. A seaman working with Marine Scotland earns up to £25,543 a year, while at CalMac they earn £32,998. Because of the downturn of the oil industry, Marine Scotland now appear to think that crew are ten a penny, and they're removing that bonus. It's been halved, and it could disappear altogether next year, in total a £5,000 pay cut. However, there are still huge issues recruiting staff, and I'm concerned that if we get back to a situation that we had in a number of years ago, vessels will have to tie up because they will not have the required staffing levels to sail safely. There's simply no reasonable excuse for the government to pay those working in Marine Scotland less than the going rate for the job, and it's bad for seafarers, it's bad for their families and communities, and it's bad for Scotland's fisheries. A Marine Scotland employee told me, "I feel the skill set that we have is being ignored compared to the job we do, and I don't see why CalMac and Marine Scotland are on two different pay scales. These jobs are tough, spending weeks away at sea, away from family. They need experience and expertise, and yet Marine Scotland cut their salaries without any negotiation. And while we're putting more pressure on these crews, we treat them abysmally, preferring to pay agency staff to fill the gaps rather than reward loyal, skilled crew. If we're to ensure a future of the industry along with the conservation of the fishing stock, we need crews working with fishermen rather than inexperienced crew working on short-term contracts. Permanent crew are not there for the money. They wouldn't be there if that was what they were after, because they're paid much more elsewhere. But they have built up an expertise working with the fishing fleet, and they're invested in the industry. And that's what we're asking for, that these crews get a fair pay settlement, not a pay cut, in order to show them that we all value the role and the work they do on our behalf." Presiding officer, turning to the larger debate and the discard ban, the incredible waste of throwing dead fish back to sea because boats don't have enough quota left to land them has been debated frequently. Surely it's an immoral waste when there are so much without enough food to feed themselves. It does nothing for conservation of stocks because the fish are already dead when they're returned, and at best an easy meal for seabirds and other predators, but does nothing at all for the species or indeed the environment. Therefore, we, like many others, advocated a discard ban. Not a ban that would stop fishers working, causing hardship to those at sea and processors on land, but a ban that would allow bycatch to be landed and used. A ban which neither punished nor rewarded boats that had caught it inadvertently. And my understanding is the current ban is to be extended to whitefish this year, and it falls short of that aim, albeit that it's being phased in. But we need to deal with any potential issues before they arise. Discarding at sea is to be banned, and anyone doing it is open to sanction and indeed charges, and ultimately a boat could be stripped of its license. To legally land bycatch, you must be able to access quota for the species that make up that bycatch. And it could be argued that if that quota was readily available, it would have never been dumped as bycatch in the first place. Therefore, it must be recognised that bycatch is made up of fish that has no quota easily available to allow it to be landed, and these fish are regarded as choke species. There is sometimes trading quota available, but there is a concern that this will be hoarded by countries for their own use and will not be traded widely enough to allow everyone to continue to fish. If trading doesn't happen, then bycatch of choke species will become illegal to land and will attract severe penalties. And therefore, crews may discard in order to keep on working, and that is illegal. The fishing industry are investing in new technology and gear to enable them to fish in a more targeted way. And technology is developing, and we must invest more in the science to get the best possible solutions, because avoiding choke species altogether is always the best outcome. But it is in all our interests that we have healthy fish stocks. However, we need a system in place that allows everything to be caught to be landed, and where there is no quota for bycatch, then there must be a way of landing it. It could be by way of flexible fines. A fine could be equivalent to the sale price of the choke species with an allowance for the time and the fuel spent in landing it. That way, crews would be able to land without penalty, but also without reward, making it unattractive for them to target that species. It's a careful balance, and it would need to be struck, but a solution must be found to allow fishers to land bycatch without being unjustifiably punished for abiding by the discard ban. Presiding officer, these debates happen every year. but they're as important as ever despite Brexit. Suffice to say that we all want the best deal for our fishing industry, a deal that ensures stocks are protected for the future generations, but also allows the current one to make a living and for all of us to have fish to eat. Our coastal communities are vulnerable and they need a stable industry for their survival. It's not just the crews and the boats that depend on a fishing industry, it's the processors and workers on shore. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I call Tavi Scott to speak to move amendment 2922.3. 7 minutes and a little bit more.
Thank you very much,
well,
Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to see the Cabinet Secretary here today. I must confess I was quite worried when I read the press in general, like Peter Chapman on Tuesday morning, because there's a very fetching photograph of Mr. Ewing in the press in general in Mr. Stevenson's constituency with his foot at a jaunty angle on the edge of the pier there, and he looks like he was just about to jump in. So and fisheries policy, I'm sure, can do that to any minister, but we're very grateful for the fact that Ewing is with us here today. I wanted to start at the other end of the debate. There's no doubt that the great majority of fishermen voted leave in June, and no wonder. The common fisheries policy run by Brussels is top-down, ineffective, and indeed woeful. It's not common, it does nothing for fish stocks, and is rarely even a policy. But one decision the then European Fisheries Commissioner took encapsulates why the industry literally hates the CFP, and indeed Brussels too. Faroe and Iceland decided some years back to prosecute the mackerel without quota. The EU did nothing other than wring its hands. Years of negotiations went nowhere, and in that time, the Faroese industry built up a catching track record of mackerel, a high-volume, high-priced species caught, of course, in a clean fishery. What then happened? The EU rewarded Faroe for years of illegal fishing with an international quota, a quota that meant a cut in mackerel caught by Shetland and Scottish pelagic vessels. And fisheries managers and politicians all expected the industry to accept that. Well, they didn't. Presiding Officer, the huge leave vote against the EU in fisheries has been building, I suspect, for decades. But that sellout of our industry's interests over Faroese mackerel quota was for many the final straw. There is no way, Presiding Officer, that I, as a constituency member, or indeed Mr. Ewing, at his most persuasive, will convince the catching sector that the EU acts in the industry's interests. And that is without even mentioning days at sea and all that went with that. So that's today why my amendment asks the government to begin work on a Scottish fisheries policy that will be needed irrespective of whatever happens with Brexit. Yeah. I've made many a speech condemning the CFP for all its manifest failures, and I'm not going to add to that today. But I want, but far more importantly, the industry wants, a policy that is better, local fisheries management, proper, accountable, and understood science, and a flexibility, as others have already mentioned, and indeed the Minister mentioned, to the reality of the fishing grounds using such techniques as real-time closed areas. My amendment makes two further points I'd ask the Cabinet Secretary to consider, and I do recognise that he's already touched on these points this afternoon. Firstly, the EU-Faroese talks that are underway just now in Brussels. We need our government to resist any further access to EU waters for the Faroese to catch mackerel. The government need to keep the pressure up on this, and I'm grateful to the Minister for his remarks earlier on. He'll understand the argument. Shetland and indeed Scottish fishermen are sick of watching Faroese boats catch mackerel in EU waters and then exporting the fish to Russia. Parliament knows why there are trade embargoes on fish to Russia. It's because of what happened in the Crimea 2 years ago. Yet the Faroese product, this mackerel, is not covered by those EU trade sanctions, so they can use a mackerel quota obtained illegally to sell fish our boats could catch to Russia. You couldn't really make it up. Who is responsible for that? So I ask the Cabinet Secretary to ensure there is no further proceedings in that area, and those EU Faroese talks end up in the right area for our industry. Secondly, the reality of the discard ban. The landing obligation, or as frankly we all know it, the discard ban, cannot work in its current form. The North Sea is a mixed whitefish fishery. Boats catch more than one species at one time. The government know that. The Cabinet Secretary certainly knows that. The RSPB briefing for today's debate makes that point too, all but in a different way. There is not, as other members have said, enough quota of certain species, and that will certainly include cod from 2017. The reality next year is that boats will be forced to stop fishing, as quota for one stock will be exhausted long before others. It's why in the northern North Sea, in Shetland waters, cod, haddock and whiting quota matter that bit more because of the catch of the local boats in the islands. Government and even the Commission know that on the choke species issue, there is still much to be done to resolve this. And yet we're pressing on as if there's no problem. The Minister, the Cabinet Secretary will be familiar with Article 2.1 of the basic regulation, the Brussels regulation, which says that the CFP shall ensure that fishing and aquaculture activities are managed in a way that is consistent with the objectives of achieving economic, social and employment benefits. Now, this is cherry picking. There is no basis in law for favouring one article over another. So why does this discard ban keep rolling out with the reform? And I say to my environmental colleagues, this policy is the worst of all worlds for all of us. It's a discard ban that doesn't work. It means limited information on what is actually being discarded, and it leads to questionable stock assessments. And poor science help none of us, particularly the industry. The Cabinet Secretary, I think I am correct, has declared that no Scottish boat will be tied up as a result of choke species. I agree with him, and I just want to ask today, he'll clarify how, during 2017, the regime will ensure that happens. So we need to ensure that the discard ban operates. I suggest that it needs to be modelled on the more sensible and workable arrangements in Norway, and we need to get our industry out of a bind that was a knee-jerk reaction, if we care to remember this, to the celebrity chef, grandstanding one night in telly. Now, it's bad enough politicians grandstanding, but celebrity chefs we really should draw the line at. Two final points, Presiding Officer, if I may. Firstly, Scottish fishermen have expressed their extreme disappointment at the blue-whiting catch arrangements for next year, finalised at last week's EU-Norway talks. I accept that the Scottish negotiating team voted against it. The Minister made that clear today, and he was right to. But the deal will see an increased access arrangement for Norway, which will enable them to catch 68% of their blue-whiting catch allocation to the west of the UK, compared to 61% before. On top of that, there will be an additional 110,000 tonnes of blue-whiting to Norway in comparison to the previous 75,000 tonnes. I think that answers, to some extent, Peter Chapman's question about Norway. All my experience of these debates over the years is if there is one thing about the Norwegians, they certainly know how to negotiate. Finally, I'm just finishing this point, if I may, Mr. Scott. The Cabinet Secretary certainly has my party's support in extracting an agreement from next week that helps fishing businesses at sea and on land from next week's EU Council. Occasionally, some of us hark back to the days of the somewhat more confrontational debates that used to take place on these matters, but frankly, not that much, because the industry needs stability and an ability to plan for the future. That is the Cabinet Secretary's task. We support him in that, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. We now move to the open debate. Call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mr. Stevenson, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have great hopes for today's debate, and in that spirit, may I start by congratulating colleagues on the Conservative benches for their candour in the amendment they made. Not everyone is prepared to acknowledge failures in negotiation shared between the UK government and perhaps the Scottish government. But I think if we acknowledge where we're not succeeding, then we've got hope of going forward. Because indeed, fishermen in Scotland have expressed their disappointment about the blue whiting catch allocation. 7 percentage points given away today, just as control over our waters was in 1983 at the end of the 10-year derogation. And that leads me to say, we might usefully look at a little bit of the history that got us to where we are today. And the reason for doing that is so that we don't repeat some of that history. The original commitment to surrender our fishing rights out to 200 miles came in 1971. It was effectively entrenched into law when Ted Heath signed the Treaty of Accession on the 22nd of January 1972. And this is the important point. It only after that was the actual treaty published and subject to democratic scrutiny. The most objectionable part of the treaty was that fishing decisions could be made by majority, sometimes a qualified majority. And the issue of opening up the result of negotiations before we get committed to them so that parliamentarians can look at them is perhaps one in another context we'll return to at a later point. Now, the fishing negotiations we're talking about today, of course, are ones so unsatisfactory that even landlocked countries in the EU can essentially block our interests. Now, the SNP have recognised all this from the very outset, and that is why we have opposed the common fisheries policy in all its forms from the beginning. And hopefully, we're going to get to a position of a reasonable consensus in this chamber. Now, my very first speech here in June 2001, well, up the road strictly, the words that I quoted then from this Parliament's European Committee, I think are equally relevant today, that we should try and get everyone to speak with one voice. There are tensions that should be buried for the common good. That was advice from the Parliament's European Committee in 2001. It's still good advice today, and I hope that we're able to do that. It's worth saying that my colleague, Donald Stewart, who was the leader of the SNP in 1982 in the Westminster debate that preceded the formation of the common fisheries policy in the current form, said on the record then of fishermen, they have been betrayed, the result was a catastrophe. And I think that we see that that is a view that was shared. Austin Mitchell, another great champion of fishing communities, it was a Labour motion, by the way, that was being debated, I should perhaps have said. It also spoke up in similar terms, as indeed did some, but not a majority of Conservatives. And certainly when the vote came at 7 o'clock at night, the Conservatives voted down a motion which would have been a proper sense of where we were at that point. Now, the thing we've got to grab hold of as well is, of course, that fisheries negotiations are not just a matter for those who catch fish. They're also a matter for our processors. In my constituency, processing is a major source of employment, many thousands of people, and people in that industry wait equally anxiously for the outcome of each year's negotiation. It's no small matter for Peterhead and Fraserburgh, where the contribution from landings was over £150 million last year. That's nearly £4,000 per head of population, a very substantial matter indeed. But it equally matters to constituents in the south of Scotland, in Eyemouth, and of course Mr. Scott's constituents in the furthest north. Now, in 1997, my political colleague, Dr. Alan McCartney, MEP, published a considered proposal for the reform of the CFP. And there's a couple of things in it that throw some light on how we got to where we are that we might take notice on. One of the things that the linguist, that Alan McCartney, was highlighted was in the Spanish Act of Succession of 1985, which essentially eliminated the ability for the UK to veto results. In part, that arose between a difference between the Spanish version of the treaty, the language was different, and the English language of the treaty. The Spanish language missed out the word solely, and it was the one that was used when the decisions were made. I see Travis Scott nodding, so he's familiar with this. So sometimes it's very simple little things that can get us into real difficulties in the long term. So he went on, and I think it's interesting to say this 1997 paper that Alan McCartney produced might form a useful basis for the policy we might adopt now. Others may take a different view. But one of the things he wrote about was what was needed, a new framework whereby coastal states with the greatest historical interests in specific fisheries would be able to take key control and management decisions relating to the fisheries in the waters off their coasts. Now, of course, he was seeking to get change within the common fisheries policy. It's quite clear the dynamic in politics and practical affairs today is somewhat different. And there may be a particular opportunity that will come. Now, I know others are going to speak about choke species. That's going to continue to be something that's a matter of importance to our communities. But one thing, too, that is an issue in the current arrangements is not enough of the fish caught in our sector is landed for the benefit of our communities and the processors in our communities. Now, it's not irrational for fishermen to go and get the highest price they can, be that in Norway or elsewhere. But I think we have to bear in mind that our quotas were given out at no cost. And if we've got new quota because of new opportunities, we have to look at a new way of doing things. Ultimately, Presiding Officer, fish is a delicious, healthy way of eating. There is a vast network of fish and chip shops across these islands for giving us all access to fish. That's what I most enjoy about fishing. But this debate is a key opportunity for us to join together. I hope at 5 o'clock we can all agree a common position to the benefit of fishing communities, fishermen and Scotland and the UK as a whole.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson. I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Marie Todd. Mr. Kerr, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. So here we are again, the annual series of summits that determine next year's fishing quotas for the EU, Norwegian, Faroese and Icelandic fishing fleets. And we await the lobbyists, the politicians, the commissioners, council officials, European Parliament staffers and journalists at the annual two-day all-night bun fight at the Berlaymont, emerging exhausted, waving the various deals and agreements they have wrestled over. It is, of course, in the main, all a front. The summit is, for the British fleet, at least a rubber-stamping exercise, with the major deals already having been agreed, with little fanfare. For our West Coast fleet, the major decisions were taken in Ireland last month at the meeting between Norway, the Faroese, the EU, where the catch limits for the key North Sea Atlantic stocks, North Atlantic stocks of mackerel and herring were decided. For our North Sea fleet, the big decisions were taken in Norway at the EU-Norway summit, with deals struck over cod, haddock, whiting, coley, plaice, North Sea mackerel and herring, and blue whiting. That doesn't mean there aren't surprises to be sprung in Brussels. Who can forget last year's summit meeting where the fishing world, expecting a quick and easy meeting, was caught on the hop by the Norwegian government's last-minute demands, against all scientific advice, for a much greater share of blue whiting. A situation only partly resolved at 2 a.m, by a European Commission fait accompli behind closed doors that left the stock with no overall tack or percentage shares and made the claim by the EU that we were all moving towards maximum sustainable yield for all stocks somewhat laughable. It placed British fishermen bound to collective bargaining by the EU at a disadvantage to their non-EU cousins. Only last week in Bergen, Norway secured another increase in their blue whiting share off the west coast of the British Isles, in return for an increase in the EU's share of Arctic cod. But British boats don't fish for Arctic cod. They fish for blue whiting. The Portuguese, French and the Dutch fish for Arctic cod. Equal access to a common resource, indeed. One thing the Brussels summit does do is to put the fishing industry at the centre of our national discourse, one of Scotland's oldest, most iconic and vital sectors, unfairly targeted for perceived overfishing, as Tavish Scott alluded to, subject to ever more stringent regulations such as the pending deep sea fishing regulation and the discard ban, ignored by the Scottish government when asking for help to prepare for the discard ban, and abandoned in Europe by the SNP, who missed key votes affecting our industry. Who can forget last year when the European Fisheries Committee, with the support of the SNP's Free Green Alliance, in conjunction with UKIP, that will be UKIP, voted to give the European Commission delegated power status over the landing obligations, meaning the discard ban for all demersal stocks would be introduced a whole year early. UKIP at least were in the room. Their representative later claimed he didn't really know what he was voting for, but the SNP were absent. Now, Stuart Stevenson calls for one voice, and I do commend the motion and the amendments where they call for support for our innovative, pioneering and hard-working fishing industry. It has been the representative bodies of that industry, the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, the producer organisations, Catherine Stack in Brussels, their predecessors, the hundreds of individuals around this country who, working with government, the European Union, scientists and innovators, have made the Scottish fishing fleet and associated shoreside operations the most innovative, forward-thinking and sustainable fishing industry in Europe. It is an industry that has made many sacrifices over the last decade to secure the return of a sustainable cod fishery. Many fishing vessels were decommissioned and many fishing careers ended due to the cod fishing restrictions of the early 2000s. But this painful sacrifice and the subsequent voluntary adoption of new fishing practices has secured a regrowth in the cod stock, so much so it is now within a hair's breadth of being reclassified as a sustainable stock by the Marine Stewardship Council. It is an industry that pioneered new nets to reduce discarding practices in the North Sea, not because they were forced to, but because they know that industry's wealth is judged not only by its income, but by the health of its resource. It is an industry that pioneered the voluntary use of CCTV monitoring on boats, because they had to be seen to be working in a lawful and sustainable way. It is an industry that has worked with Marine Scotland on the Scottish Fishermen's Federation onboard observer scheme, ensuring that fisheries management decisions are based upon informed advice and not guesswork or estimates. It is an industry that has created the most professional and well-equipped support network of scientific, policy, non-executive and voluntary bodies to promote dialogue between regulators, legislators and fishermen in the world. And so we are pleased to back much of this motion, calling for the best possible deal from the fishing negotiations, which I have every confidence will be delivered by George Eustace and his team. And we very much support the Scottish Government in its efforts to achieve the best possible outcome for Scotland's fishermen, coastal communities and wider seafood sectors. Our amendment notes the blue whiting issue and also seeks to recognise the real opportunity of sustained economic benefit for our coastal communities and every seafood sector presented by Brexit. But such benefits can only happen if parliamentarians from all parts of the spectrum join together and throw their support behind our fishing communities to ensure the best possible deal for fishing. And as we give that support, let us in this chamber never forget that tonight, as on every night, there are those out on the boats willing to risk all weathers, to risk life and limb, to put food on our tables, something for which I am sure all in this chamber are eternally grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kerr. I call Marie Todd, to be followed by Claudia Beamish. Ms. Todd, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I grew up in a village which was quite literally built by fishing. Ullapool on the shores of Loch Broom was founded as a herring port in 1788 by the British Fisheries Society. There's a lot less herring landed there today, but it's still one of the 10 major fishing ports in the UK. In Scotland, we're fortunate to have such a vast and rich sea to fish in, and we must value it. We must use good quality scientific research to inform our stewardship so that we can realise the industry's full potential. Scotland's seafood sector is already one of our great strengths and one of our most successful exports, and Scottish seafood's already achieved much in building its reputation as a product renowned the world over for pristine quality. In 2014, it made up 60% of all food exports to the EU. Fishing is at the heart of coastal communities all over Scotland, and as a Highlands and Islands representative, I represent many of those communities. The industry has provided much needed jobs in my region. Take Shetland, for example. In Shetland, fishing is a bigger contributor to the economy than the oil industry, and unemployment there is low. I've stated before in this chamber that Shetland lands more than a fifth of the UK's fish, more than England, Wales and Northern Ireland added together. That's why the Scottish Government will always stand up for fishing. The industry may only be a small part of the UK economy, but it's absolutely vital for Scotland. I think it's important to address Brexit in this debate because it's been argued that Brexit is an opportunity for the fishing industry, and that prospect caused many of the people in fishing communities to vote for it. I don't doubt that there should be opportunities for fishing post-Brexit, but like many people in my community, I fear the UK government will once again consider the industry expendable and once again barter away our interests. Are we expected to believe that fishing rights in Scottish waters will take precedence over passporting arrangements for London's financial sector? As well as opportunities with Brexit, there may be some risks. It's clear that the EU is a valuable market. The shellfish that's landed in Ullapool goes straight to market in France and in Spain. I hear people expressing concerns about losing investment in harbour infrastructure and the viability of fish processing if EU nationals can't work here. EU funding also supports the science data and compliance cost, which is necessary to manage and support the industry. I have to say, though, it would be hard for me to have grown up in Ullapool and not share some of the concerns about the common fisheries policy. At the moment, fishermen in my constituency are finding the landing obligation really, really challenging. Everyone agrees that the discard ban is a laudable aspiration, but in a mixed fishery, it is really hard to achieve. And with new fish species being added, the chance of choke species occurring is high, and the unintended consequence of having boats tied up is really hard to take. As you can imagine, the people in my community want to ensure that boats keep fishing if possible. When you tie up a boat, it's like closing down a business. It's important that we strike the right balance between the urge to fish as much as possible and the need to plan for sustainable management of our fisheries, which we cannot afford to deplete. It's my understanding that the UK Fisheries Minister, Mr. Eustace, could have at any time during his tenure started discussions on changing shares and negotiated better quotas for choke species. If he'd done so, many, if not all, of the challenges facing the industry in relation to the discard ban would already have been alleviated. I was really pleased to hear Mr. Ewing is working on a solution to this vexing problem. After the quota negotiations are completed, I would urge Marine Scotland to ensure that final allocations of the quota are conducted as speedily as possible. The earlier our boats have certainty about the final allocations, the more effectively they'll be able to plan for the coming year. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that this happens more swiftly than in previous years. I'd like to conclude by offering my support to the Cabinet Secretary with the negotiations. We're well aware in the Highlands that Fergus Ewing has a strong record for getting into the nuts and bolts of industries and listening to everyone involved. He's a strong record of standing up for Scottish industries. He stood up for Scottish Steel as Minister, and more recently he stood up and protected the workers at Fort William Aluminium Smelter during the sale of Rio Tinto. I have no doubt that he will ensure that our fishing industry gets the best possible deal from any negotiation.
Thank you, Ms. Todd. Call Claudia Beamish to be followed by John Finney. Ms. Beamish, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too wish the Cabinet Secretary well on his negotiating trip with the UK delegation. Reaching an agreement on our shared stocks is a challenge made more complex by competing demands. And as the Cabinet Secretary said in his opening speech today, balancing and compromises sometimes have to be found. But I'd support the Scottish Government to seek the best arrangement for our coastal communities with respect to the pillars of science and sustainability. Protecting and enhancing our natural marine environment goes hand in hand with a strong, resilient fishing industry. Furthermore, the context of global food security and food carbon emissions shows the value of the fishing industry as a more carbon-friendly and important source of nutrition for much of the world than other forms of protein, making up 15 to 20% of global protein intake. Changes to our climate can alter delicate habitats and balanced ecosystems, and I seek assurance from the Cabinet Secretary that Marine Scotland will be secure in funding to monitor this, protecting the industry and the marine environment from adverse climate effects. I look forward to the upcoming Climate Action Plan as well, and expect it to offer some greater commitment to blue carbon and the opportunities there. In this debate last year, I argued strongly that strong partnerships at all levels and a determination to work together would move us towards a future positive. Brexit means we are now in a very different position faced today, and I'm listening carefully to the comments from across the chamber on this. Faced with much uncertainty, but that sentiment about regionalisation still stands. At risk of repeating myself and colleagues, fish know no borders. Whatever the outcome of the EU referendum results, Scotland must uphold the values of collaboration and ensure a future of high quality, sustainable regulation, and consequently, a thriving fishing industry. Perhaps thankfully, those negotiations are for another day. And this December, the focus should be on implementing current regulation and setting our fishing stocks and industry up for a bountiful and sustainable year ahead. And I too recognise the work of the fishermen represented in the gallery and those not, of course, not able to be here today because they're working for the industry. Again this year, North Sea cod provides a good news story in many ways. The stock shows signs of continued recovery thanks to the transition and actions of our fishermen, and could be certified as sustainable next year, as we've heard from other members. Welcome news for fishermen, the environment, and of course, the hungry. When our fishing policy is anchored in biological, social, and economic data, we give our environment and industry the best possible footing. Congratulations must also go to the Scottish Fishermen's Federation for their recent success at the Green Energy Awards. In conjunction with Skills Development Scotland and Moray Offshore Renewables Limited, as many will know in the Chamber, the Federation has enabled fishermen to upskill and shift into offshore wind, the wind sector in the Moray Firth. I applaud these outstanding efforts. Scotland's fishing fleets have unique skills and knowledge that can add value to many other sectors as well, if and when there is a transition needed in the future. And I stress the word if. The fact remains that the fishing industry has faced a number of limitations and requirements to enable a durable industry. In this context, it is vital that paths to diversification are clear for businesses and communities. And I want to focus for a few moments on the Marine Maritime and Fisheries Fund, which is instrumental in this aim. Protecting sustainable growth and financing projects for job creation, offering significant support in economic diversification. Reinforcing the community-led approach to sustainable development of fishing areas is hugely important, and the EMFF can empower young people by aiding startups or training for the unemployed. It can progress family businesses by training members and spouses of those in the fishing industry. Smaller scale fleets can be advised on additional routes of income within other maritime sectors, and support like this can gel coastal communities together and fortify them for the future. It is essential that the EMFF support continues beyond Article 50. Our fishing stocks are only a sustainable source with proper management, and the EMFF is a valuable resource to ensure that the industry understands these complex challenges that it faces and is supported in these. The fund has been made, if I can be regional for a few moments, has made an impact as well as across the country in the Scottish Borders, and the Fourth Fisheries Local Action Group has delivered 1.05 million of funding to support the diversification of catching and processing, importantly, the development of tourism and food and drink, and the expansion into opportunities in offshore wind and renewables. I also encourage any SME community group or harbour trust across Scotland to consider applying for funding. The landing obligation is indeed a quandary for both fishermen and implementers, but it is another important step in the future-proofing of our marine environment and industries. And in 2007, 47% of all whitefish catches in the North Sea were discarded, and last year, I understand this was brought down to 16%, an inspiring turnaround, and thanks to measures taken by fishermen themselves. The wastefulness of throwing back, as we've heard from Rhoda Grant and others, is a practice which is truly shocking in a world where people go hungry in our own country with food banks, and we must make sure that this is avoided and ways are found to deal with it. I will end by supporting the amendment by Rhoda Grant on a fair pay settlement that recognises the experience and skills of Marine Scotland staff and the risks that they take, as do fishermen, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary today will be able to support the Scottish Labour motion. And I wish all the fishermen around the coasts of Scotland very good luck for the winter season and the dangers and the challenges that they will face to put a whole range of fish, some of it very new and interesting and exciting, onto our plates. And again, I wish the Cabinet Secretary good luck in the negotiations. Thank you.
Thank you. I call John Finney to be followed by Kate Forbes. Mr. Finney, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our National Marine Plan talks about clean, healthy, safe, productive and diverse seas managed to meet the long-term needs of nature and people. And I hope we'd all be supportive of that position. My colleague Gil Ross alluded to the term expendable earlier, and I was going to mention that. It's certainly the case that our proud industry, as the Cabinet Secretary referred to, was never expendable and should never be expendable. It wasn't right then, and it's not right in the future. But I have to say, I do gain the impression from a lot of the discussion, not in the Chamber today, but in the press and elsewhere, that some people view this as payback time. if Scotland leaves the EU. The Leave campaign talked about, quote, escaping the disastrous CFP, and again, quote, claim back our fish. Well, that's a very highly simplistic approach. Devising any new management regime will be much more complicated than that for a number of the reasons that have already been alluded to. The mobility of the commercial species that are fished, which indeed travel through the waters of several countries during their lifetime. And it's absolutely crucial in everything that we do that we determine the actual distribution and abundance of fish stocks from independent research, not just from landings. That's important. And that would include the key spawning and nursery areas and migration pathways. Because the North Sea, which has frequently been mentioned in this debate, is bounded by seven countries. So the EU, the UK, Scotland, indeed our coastal communities have a shared responsibility to manage that. And certainly the position of the Scottish Green Party, we want to protect these vital stocks, and we would seek to have the CFP extend powers for regional management bodies that would help stakeholders to work together to prevent unsustainable exploitation of fish stocks and actively recover the habitats that make up our marine environment. Supporting prioritising high-value, low-impact fishing methods which support coastal communities, and it's important that we do mention the communities. This isn't some abstract industry. This supports the land-based communities too. And certainly, although apparently not hugely relevant to today's debate, we would also want a moratorium on new... Certainly.
John Scott.
I'm concerned that no one has yet mentioned, without wishing to reincarnate Jamie McGregor, the West Coast fisheries and the depletion of the stocks there, which seem to be a continuing and abiding problem. The Minister touched on it, but I wonder if the Greens have any answers to that problem, which appears to have been intractable for as long as I can remember, and since it doesn't appear that anyone has managed to resolve it yet. Do you have any ideas how the depletion of stocks might be reversed in the West Coast fisheries and also the Firth of Clyde?
John Finney.
Well, not personally, but what I would commend to Mr. Scott, and I come on to commend, is that everything has a scientific basis rather than a simple commercial exploitation basis. And that's what we would commend. And indeed, the Cabinet Secretary, in one of his comments, talked about respecting scientific evidence, and that's very important. And the role that Scotland's marine protected areas play, planning based on scientific evidence with them too, and it's important that communities are engaged on that, so that the protected areas are something that's done with communities than is often seen as done to communities. Now, I know that there are conflicts between groups, and certainly Scottish Green Party supports sustainable fishing, and if you don't have a fishing industry where there historically was one, then clearly that hasn't been a sustainable fishery. Certainly we are very concerned about the destructive methods of dredging, which damages the environment, and also would refute the nonsense about ploughing the seabed to restore it. Anyone can see the damage that's been done. There's ample video evidence out there about how marine areas can recover. We've seen it in some of the restricted areas in Wester Ross. And what we want to do is view our maritime resources as an entire community resource. And likewise with representative bodies, much has been made of references to the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, but of course they don't speak for the whole industry, and I commend the role that the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Association play, indeed the Fishermen's Federations, and I'm sure that the Cabinet Secretary will have engagement with all bodies, and not just that single body. And what, of course, we've seen over the weekend is talk of efforts to evade the scrutiny that's absolutely vital to ensure that our marine stocks are maintained. Marine monitoring is vital, and the role, and for that reason, we will, of course, the Green Party will be supporting the Labour Party amendment tonight, because the important role that these staff play in preserving our fishing stocks, and as has been said, there should be no situation where there's any loss of remuneration for these important public employees, indeed public servants who work in very hazardous circumstances. There are some positives that have come out of the Common Fisheries Policy. I know that that many have derided it, but it's undoubtedly the case that there have been some benefits, and not everything can be transferred into pounds, shillings and pence on the quayside. The situation with discards has often been referred to here, and again, the benefits of sustainable fishery will is one of the benefits of a discard ban, and the potential to increase overall fishing revenue and resilience. And it is about selectivity, and much has been made in comments past about the innovation that's been put in place with gear, and we would certainly support that. There are clear economic arguments for that. In the time I've left, I'd like to commend just some of the briefings that's been received. It's been alluded to the WWF RSPB, and that catch limits are in accordance with scientific advice. We may all have our wish to see maximised catches, but as Mr Scott has alluded to, where historically there has been a fishery and there's no longer a fishery, shows that that method didn't work, and certainly some of the tactics employed in the 70s and 80s have contributed to that. And that's important because we need to retain a reputation as a supplier of high quality and sustainable food. I think I'll just close at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finney. Call Kate Forbes, to be followed by Ross Thompson. Ms. Forbes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As an MSP that represents fishing communities on the East and West Coasts and believes passionately in their future, because these technical international discussions with experts that we've been discussing have far-reaching ripples on homes and communities in Skye, Lochaber and Rossshire. And it's been a privilege to meet and chat to fishermen working with different gear in Mallig, Kyle, Kailaken, Portree and Och and their families over the course of the last few months. And this speech is largely based on conversations with representatives of the industry in those communities. I've also spoken to those who transport the stock and the processors and suppliers of our finest world-renowned seafood, scallops, langoustines and lobsters, to name just a few, and sadly most of which is exported. But despite the high renown in which the produce of our seas is held globally, it is delivered despite a legislative system which hamstrings our fishing industry. And the economic consequences are arguably not half as grave as the social impact on communities. The loss of a few boats in coastal villages like Mallig impacts on everyone: the harbour, the ice factory, the knock-on effect for transport operations, and so on. We do not wish to see young families leaving or deciding not to relocate to rural areas because there are no jobs, which could also adversely impact on schools. And in terms of the question earlier from Mr. Scott about depletion, I personally think we need to involve fishermen more rather than imposing legislation on them, and we need more effective monitoring at sea. Whilst I recognise that remote electronic monitoring will only be effective if it applies to every boat in a particular area, I would like to see it being used more. And I think then those figures, in terms of boosting those figures, we need to make better use of existing resources and technology to monitor that and to involve fishermen in understanding how we reverse that depletion. So it is vital that the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary fights to ensure that the negotiated settlement promotes sustainable fisheries and has the best interests of Scotland's fishermen, coastal communities and wider seafood sectors at its heart. And in this period of uncertainty about our future in the EU, we all need to do all that we can to make it easier, simpler and more profitable for our fishermen, and to support strong trade and high consumer confidence in Scottish seafood. Because without a market, and the EU is a significant market, there is no fishing. But without fishing boats, it's irrelevant whether or not there's a market. And I recognise that many, though not all, fishermen voted for Brexit in the hope that it would result in a fairer deal and more control, which are legitimate ambitions. But I would say that it will be the same UK government negotiating the Brexit deal that has negotiated for Scottish fishermen for decades. And only a few months ago, the current Secretary of State for Scotland, Mr. Mundell, said in relation to the outcome of Brexit, "There is no way we would just go back to Scotland or Britain controlling British waters." Now, I humbly and honestly confess at the outset that I have found the history and the current legislation for the fishing industry in Scotland a baffling concoction of rules and regulations. A system is of little use if it's impossible to comply with. And so I'm pleased that the Cabinet Secretary is working hard to develop solutions to choke species so that our fleet is not placed in impossible positions. And in terms of landing obligations, fishermen require time and support to make the necessary adjustments to the new requirements. Scotland has huge potential to market high-quality, sustainable seafood, and we must continue to work hard on providing confidence that this is the case. And I welcome the Scottish Government's pledge that in next week's negotiations with the EU Council, the Government will support catch limits in accordance with sound scientific advice. And it comes back to my earlier point, and a point that Mr. Finney made well, that all of this must depend on sound science. But whilst we must take a long-term view and implement sound measures for sustainable fishing, recognising the importance of fishing to our economy, I finish where I started. And that's to say that we can't lose sight of what we're really talking about here, and that is protecting livelihoods and families and communities and schools and shops. In other words, we're protecting a sustainable population. The task before this government now is to champion our fishermen in the wake of the Brexit vote, in the wake of uncertainty, and in the wake of my personal total lack of confidence in this UK government to negotiate a deal that benefits our Scottish fishermen. I would like to see the Cabinet Secretary, and I'm pleased that he said he will do that, keep the UK government's feet to the fire to make sure they don't treat our Scottish fisheries as dispensable and non-essential in Brexit negotiations. I agree there is a sea of opportunity here, and I would urge the opposition members to get behind Mr. Ewing's motion today and to work together to make Scotland a European leader for fishing. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Ross Thompson, to be followed by Gail Ross. Mr. Thompson, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As has always been the case since the EU's Common Fisheries Policy came into existence, the position of UK fishermen is negotiated on their behalf by the EU, while Norway, as a sovereign nation, negotiates in the interests of its own fishermen and coastal communities. In this latest round of EU-Norway fisheries negotiations, we again have the same old tiresome story. The EU failing to stand up for the interests of UK and in particular Scottish fishermen. Instead, the EU buckled to the demands of Norway over access to North Sea fisheries. The negotiations gave rise to an increase in the Norwegian quota for blue whiting next year. However, there is no reciprocal uplift for UK fishermen. Thereby, the European Commission, in its wisdom, has signed a deal that gives 110,000 tonnes of blue whiting to Norway and increases their access to Scottish waters. This, Deputy Presiding Officer, is entirely unfair on hard-working Scottish fishermen. It is therefore, I would like to make some progress, but I will take interventions. It is therefore no wonder that our fishing communities voted overwhelmingly to leave the European Union. And in so doing, they voted to take back control of our waters so that UK fishing interests can be directly represented at the negotiating table and we can take a leaf out of the Norwegian playbook in making fair deals which actually benefit our fishermen. Yes?
Gail Ross.
Maybe we should take a leaf out of Norway's book and become an independent country and then we would be able to sit at the table ourselves. Does the member agree?
Ross Thompson.
We can sit at the table ourselves with the powers that will return to this Parliament. So I hope that is now an endorsement from the SNP benches that powers will come to this Parliament and MSPs can make those decisions and we can represent our own fishermen. In the current landscape, we are shackled by the EU's labyrinth of rules and red tape. We have a situation where 70% of UK fisheries resources are in the hands of the EU, worth a total of £1.6 billion. This has been devastating to our fishing industry. 60% of the UK fleet has been scrapped due to this loss of resources. Employment is halved, with there being no major fishing port between Peterhead and Plymouth. Whilst at the same time, other European countries have built boats with EU grants to fish in our waters, resulting in over 1 billion of fish being caught by foreign boats in our own waters. Over 60% of fish quotas in British waters are in foreign hands. This is quite simply madness. To put it another way, the UK owns 70% of the EU's fishing grounds, but only 15% of the quota. Now, as I'm sure that Alec Neil, if he was in the chamber today, would agree with me, and no doubt some sitting on the SNP benches this afternoon would too, the decision to leave the EU gives us a golden opportunity to be a major player in the fisheries sector, like Norway, Iceland, and the Faroe Islands. We will have the ability to introduce an environmentally friendly, economically beneficial fisheries policy determined by members sitting in this Parliament who understand, appreciate and support our local fishing communities. And happily so.
Stuart Stevenson.
One of the big differences, of course, the Norwegian fishermen actually sit in on the negotiations. It's not just perhaps a matter for parliamentarians, but for those who are the experts, who are generally the fishermen.
Stuart Stevenson didn't dispute the point, like the First Minister, that powers over this area will come to this Parliament, and MSPs sitting in this chamber will make decisions on what a Scottish fisheries policy would be instead of incoherent, ineffective and democratically deficient policies currently devised by unelected commissioners in Brussels. Our fishermen most certainly want us to seize the opportunities presented by a post-Brexit landscape. Bertie Armstrong, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, said that leaving the EU would give our fishing fleets the ability to recover proper, sustainable, rational stewardship through our own exclusive economic zone for fisheries. Mr. Armstrong continued that for Scotland's economically important fishing industry, we believe the new opportunities presented by the referendum results are overwhelmingly for the better. The fishing industry across the UK is speaking with one voice in calling for politicians both north and south of the border to support their common cause, which is that Brexit offers a real opportunity of sustained economic benefit for our coastal communities and every seafood sector. To work together to deliver the opportunities of Brexit, rather than squabble about the process, or in the case of this SNP government, do everything it can to keep Scotland in the EU, selling out our fishermen to Brussels. The SNP keep telling us that they believe Scotland should be independent, it was highlighted in recent interventions, to govern our own affairs. Yet on fishing, they're not just happy to forfeit the power to decide policy in Scotland by elected MSPs in favour of unelected EU commissioners, but are actively working to achieve just that. The SNP are completely out of touch with this most crucial Scottish industry. Their current policy stance will shortchange our hard-working fishermen. Perhaps now is the time for members, maybe such as Stuart Stevenson or perhaps even Richard Lockhead, to use this opportunity to clarify their own position. Are they part of Alec Neil's magic circle of nationalist Brexiteers? Yes, absolutely.
Stuart Stevenson.
Has the member signed my motion, which will be subject to a members' debate in about a month's time, which supports the Sea of Opportunity initiative by the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, which addresses precisely the points the member is making?
Ross Thompson.
That is not actually an answer to the point that I made about whether or not you voted to leave, Mr. Stevenson. So clearly your answer is that you still want fishermen to receive their orders from Jean-Claude Juncker and sacrifice their industry on the altar of ever closer EU integration. We all know that Alec Neil didn't want to rock the boat by coming out in favour of leaving the EU before the referendum vote. So now that it's passed, where are the rest of them? Today's Herald reports on the National Centre for Social Research, which says that more than a third of SNP supporters voted to leave. Therefore, Deputy Presiding Officer, statistically, there are some sitting in the chamber now. So come on, you can't possibly leave Alec out on his own, all at sea, on this one. Or are you going to abandon him like you're abandoning the fishing communities of Scotland? Deputy Presiding Officer, the SNP campaign on the premise that they're stronger for Scotland, but it seems like they're just stronger for Brussels when it comes to this issue. This Parliament can show our support for our fishing communities by working together to seize the sea of opportunity that lies ahead.
Gail Ross, followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sorry. I think I might just sit back down again. Tavish Scott didn't want to talk about the Common Fisheries policy in depth, but when I saw that there was to be a debate about fishing, I was reminded of an essay in the Scottish Review written by Shetlander, Robert Lowes, in 2004. and he likened the EU common fisheries policy of the time to a birthday cake. So I'm going to do something a little bit different. With your indulgence, Presiding Officer, I quote, "Imagine a large, plump fruit cake, a grand birthday cake, candles, icing, everything, a cake anyone would want to taste. Who gets this birthday cake? Well, to be fair, everyone around the table who has come to the party should get a slice. So who divides it up? Not the host, who might have favourites amongst the guests. A cake commission will have to be set up, and they will divide it up. Fine. However, one of the guests demands a slightly bigger slice, because in the past, he always got a slightly bigger slice. Well, this will have to be proven, says the cake commission, from past cake records. And if we were actually getting around to measuring slices, how big is the actual cake itself? To avoid squabbling, scientific evidence of the exact size of the cake will be required at each and every birthday in the future. Another guest is watching his waistline. He decides his slice is just too much for his reduced appetite, so he will eat only part of it and sell the rest to his neighbour, who it seems has an insatiable appetite for cake. Ah, yes, but when we come to divide up next year's cake, how is that slice reckoned? Did it belong to the full man or the hungry man? Could it be used as an argument for the hungry man to get a larger slice and the thin man to get less the next time round? The guests are getting greedy, so it's agreed to make tea plates smaller and even remove a few altogether to try and cut the demand for cake. Then, a real dilemma. Someone else is knocking on the door. Someone known to be incredibly hungry who has travelled some way to come to the party. The guests can't exclude him from the party. That would be very rude. But if this hungry person comes to the table, there will be less cake than ever to go round. So new sharing rules must be devised, the new arrival stalled as long as possible. Questions are asked about the new guest's entitlement to come to the party. Who invited him? And while all this goes on, he starts quietly buying up all the surplus cake crumbs he can get his hands on, so that when he does get through the door, he can knead it into a sizeable lump and insist that this is his historic slice, ready for when next year's cake appears." Unquote. Presiding Officer, fishing as an industry has historically been one of the most important in Scotland, and my constituency, indeed my hometown of Wick, saw one of the most remarkable periods in Scottish fishing, the boom of the herring industry, and it would be remiss of me not to mention that today. It was during the 18th, 19th and early part of the 20th century that Wick was the largest herring port in Europe. And by 1865, records show that 1,100 vessels from Wick and the surrounding areas were engaged during the herring fishing season. Herring fish lived in vast quantities in the waters around Scotland and was a relatively easy catch. The final years of Wick's association with the herring industry was during a short period following World War II. By 1953, it was all over, overfished. And almost 200 years of the herring industry became resigned to the history books. Coming back to the present day, Presiding Officer, Scotland is still placed to have the best fishing in Europe. We export over £400 million of seafood to the EU every year to a market of 500 million people, and no matter what happens, we need continued access to that market. And there is still cake in the form of the EU Common Fisheries Policy, which saw reform in 2013. In 1973, we were sold a haddie by the UK government when Ted Heath said that fishing was expendable. So I commend Fergus Ewan's efforts to ensure that fishing continues as a key priority for Scotland, and I echo Claudia Beamish's calls of thanks to our fishermen and for them to stay safe. Thank you.
Edward Mountain, followed by Emma Harper, and I do have a little time in hand, so could give extra time for interventions.
Presiding Officer, thank you, and I'm sorry there's going to be no stories about cake from me. It will just make me hungry and might shorten what I'm going to say. Now, no one's going to stand in this chamber and downgrade the importance of the fishing industry to Scotland, not only to Scotland, but of course to the whole UK. It's not just the value to the economy that's important, but it's the great value in terms of social, cultural heritage, to say nothing of the jobs it provides in the fragile rural areas of Scotland. Now, as the Cabinet Secretary said, the fact that Scotland makes up just about 8.6% of the UK's population and landed 78% of the UK's total catch illustrates the importance this catch is to Scotland as well as the UK. Now, before I'd like to go any further, I'd like to reiterate that I believe it's important that we look to the management of this wild resource across the human boundaries that we've imposed and look at the big picture. Fish within the UK's territorial limit may be in Norway's territorial limit tomorrow. Fish don't need passports and they don't respect national or nationalist aspirations. As I make this speech, I believe that EU officials will already have made agreements with non-EU countries such as Norway. The most recent EU-Norway talks, I believe, ended last Friday to agree their catch limits and their quotas, as we've heard, on fish such as cod. So that means that all, and I don't really mean all, that is left to do is for the EU to decide who gets to catch what within the European Union and over what they have a jurisdiction over. Now, before I discuss the negotiations, I want to mention a few important figures that are important to the Highlands. First of all, in relation to fisheries, as I believe Gail Ross pointed out and Mary Todd pointed out, there are very important onshore industries that rely on them. And for example, in Scrabster Harbour, one of the top landing ports of the UK, situated as the most northerly mainland port, it's an ideal place for the people to work the north, fishermen who work the north and west of Scotland. It not only lands whitefish, as we know, but shellfish, lobsters, and scallops and prawns. A multitude of vessels go in and out and utilise the port handily, and estimated value of landings are in excess of 20 million. But this port is not just important to the fishermen. It's the fishermen's, or the businesses support them. For example, D. Stephen and Son, who run a fleet of 30 lorries and employ 55 people. The lorries deliver fish and produce across the whole of the UK and into Europe. A leading business, and it's vital not only to Scotland, but the UK economy, and as well as the well-being of Caithness. They're not alone. There are other firms in the north, Bannerman's of Tame and Ferguson Transport, two excellent hauliers to whom fish and fisheries are very important. And indeed, I should point out, as has already been done, that Scrabster is not the only port in the Highlands. There are many others that play their part in these fragile areas. So the negotiations that are going to be undertaken between Council and the sovereign states are critical. It's important that the UK stands together to get the best deal for Europe so that Scotland's predetermined share of the UK quota can be as high as possible. There seems to be little point to me in what has happened in the past with the nature of people fruitlessly posturising on the sidelines over catches. The EU law says that negotiations are for sovereign states to conclude, and therefore the team must be pulled together in one direction. Whilst travelling in one direction, it will be a winning formula. To try and pull in two different directions will be a absolute recipe for disaster. So I therefore welcome the points that Fergus Ewing made and the approach that he appears to be taking to work within the UK. Now, I'd briefly like to mention the discard ban. I could never and will never ever see the point of throwing dead and edible fish back into the sea. I therefore am pleased that the ban itself is being phased out. And I'm pleased that the discard ban will be extended to all tax beaches by the end of 2019. However, I am seriously concerned by the way the landings of fish that would have been discarded is being addressed, and I want to see considerably more work and effort being put into resolving this. Now, looking to the future, it's important that we are mindful of 2020 and Brexit. Let me be clear, and I will be clear, as some other people in this Parliament are not. I did not vote for Brexit. I voted to remain, but I accept the democratic decision of the UK. And I will not be like Private James Fraser of Dad's Army, and like some people in this chamber are, and run around saying that we are doomed. Unlike him, and unlike some people in this chamber, I don't crave more power and cave in when I'm challenged on it. We have a future, and I believe the Scottish Fishermen's Federation believe that we present ourselves, and Brexit does, with a sea of opportunities. We should grasp that. What we should do is take, as I've said before in this chamber, a can-do attitude and look for the positives and not for the negatives. Bertie Armstrong, I believe, said that there were encouraging results from the tax that were agreed last year. We need to take those opportunities and build on them. But I would also point out and remind George Eustace that in moving forward, that we have to ensure that we are not outflanked by the EU, who want to secure their position and compliance post-2020. Our fishing industry is too important to be used as a pawn in a chess game, and I will always stand up for our fishermen in ensuring that it's not. Yes, I will take an amendment.
John Finney.
Thank you. Are the shared EU citizens in our constituency too important to be used as a bargaining tool in this Brexit debate?
Edward Mountain.
Thank you. And Mr. Finney raises a point, is that actually the vote was across the whole of the UK, and it was a decision taken by the whole of the UK, and I agree to abide by democratic decisions. And I'm afraid that if you're not prepared to abide by democratic decisions, one has to be asked why at the end of the day you're a politician. Now, I'd like to briefly mention before I conclude, if I have time, presiding officer, is a brief mention of the inshore fisheries. There is a lot going on there, and there will be a lot going on in this Parliament regarding inshore fisheries. And I believe the Scottish Government is going to bring forward legislation regarding these. I would urge the Scottish Government to do as they are suggesting that Europe should do now, and base their decision and their policy on scientific grounds, and make sure that the science is good to support what we are suggesting that our inshore fisheries can do. So in summary, I believe we have opportunities here to reverse the decline in landings that we saw in 2015. We can also reverse the decline in the fishing vessels, which has dropped in the same period. We need to accelerate the small increase in employment, which has occurred in the same period. We need a successful outcome, which will only be achieved by a united front of these negotiations, which will mean that our communities across Scotland and the UK can look at a better future in terms of jobs, economic activity and sustainable production. Thank you.
Emma Harper, this is the last of the open speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I continue, I'd like to remind everybody that I am the Parliamentary Liaison Officer for Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and Connectivity. Gail Ross might have cake, but I've got pie. So, this pie is the Marine Socioeconomics Project pie, and statistics, percentages and facts about fishing and the economic impact of our product that is brought to the market is represented in this pie. 0.2% is the GDP that Scottish fishing contributes to the whole of the UK, but that equals £770 million. And, you know, we might see that as quite small, but that piece of my pie represents jobs, homes, communities, the livelihood of people, and the people in the coastal communities. And I think that's really important. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, marking the importance of recent and ongoing negotiations for Scotland's fishing industry. As the Cabinet Secretary remarked in his opening speech, the Scottish Government remains committed to eliminating discards through the reformed Common Fisheries Policy. However, I was equally pleased to hear him highlight the importance of protecting the livelihoods of our fishermen by safeguarding their right to fish when there is still quota available. Striking the difficult balance between sustainable economic growth and environmental conservation has always been a challenge associated with the rural economy, and we are fortunate to have a Cabinet Secretary who understands that. While the negotiated settlement must aim to eliminate discards and tackle the challenges presented by choke species, we must also be mindful of the difficulties presented to the fleet in complying with the legislation and support them to make the necessary adjustments. Presiding Officer, becoming a member of the European and External Relations Committee has served me well in recent months as a rural MSP. So much of what occupies us after June's referendum result has serious implications for the industries at the centre of our economy. And as I've mentioned with my pie, fishing is yet another example of this. While it is important to acknowledge why some of the industry voted to leave the European Union and to explore opportunities out with that union, I wasn't one of them, by the way. I voted to remain, just get that in the record, for Mr. Mountain, who's now not in the chamber. And to explore the opportunities out of that union, it's not an insignificant task facing us now to ensure that Westminster does not negotiate away Scottish waters to European vessels with any exit deal. Historically, Scotland's fishermen have been shamefully treated by successive Westminster governments during annual fisheries negotiations, and this cannot be allowed to be replicated in deals struck as we are taken out of the European Union.
Will the member take an intervention?
Yes, I certainly will.
Stuart Stevenson.
We heard previously from Ross Thompson his objection to what he described as unelected commissioners making decisions. They are, of course, approved by the European Parliament, their appointments. Does the member think that it would be even more regrettable if unelected members of the House of Lords, who are not approved in their appointment as ministers by Parliament, were to have any role whatsoever in fisheries negotiations?
Emma Harper.
I thank Stuart Stevenson for that intervention. I would rather have us sit round the table negotiating for our fishermen on behalf of our fishermen so that the Scottish voice is heard at any negotiating table. Historically, our Scotland's fishermen, they have been treated badly, but despite landing almost 80% of fish caught in UK waters, Scotland receives only 40% of the UK share of the EU Fisheries Fund. Despite being strategically placed to have the best fishing industry in Europe, we have never been allowed to lead for the UK in European fishing negotiations where it is appropriate to do so. The Scottish fishing fleet was betrayed by the Tories in the 1970s when the UK signed up to the Common Fisheries Policy. Just let me finish this paragraph, please. The Scottish fishing fleet was betrayed by the Tories in the 1970s when the UK signed up to the Common Fisheries Policy. Papers from the Scotland Office showed how our industry was treated as expendable, which Mr. Chapman agreed with sometime in the wording earlier. I'll take your intervention. Thank you.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much. I'm pleased you took an intervention. Thank you. Just to ask the member if he could just explain to me what the European law is in regarding the negotiations at Council. Can that be taken part? Does that have to be done by the member state, or can it be done by anyone?
Emma Harper.
I am not a member of the European Union. I am not part of any negotiations. You know, I'm a new member of this chamber, so I am at this present time unaware of how the negotiations occur, but I would be happy to provide you with that information or clarity as we proceed. Yes, I will.
Stuart Stevenson.
The member perhaps is not aware that while it is, of course, the member state that negotiates, there have been examples where the Scottish minister has led as a UK minister representing the whole UK. For example, in education, where Mike Russell led for the UK in councils. So it is entirely proper and established practice for Scottish ministers to lead UK delegations in European negotiations.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson, for helping me. I would be happy to rely on your expertise in the future because I think it's great having you in the chamber. I'll buy my beer later. It is vital that we reject any attempts to undermine the sector in Scotland during the next few years of important negotiations with the EU. And I'm pleased to hear that the Cabinet Secretary is pressing Ms. Leadsom on the issue. I was less heartened to see that in recent correspondence, George Eustace, MP, Minister of State for Agriculture, Fisheries and Food, he reaffirmed his intention to work with the Scottish Government throughout these negotiations. And it's conditional that we, and this is his quote, strive for a fair deal that benefits the UK as a whole. I think he could have said a deal that benefits the UK and Scotland as a whole. The Minister of State's language does not give me hope that Westminster are any closer to acknowledging the disproportionate contribution Scottish fishermen make to the UK-wide sector. The EU represents the largest food export market for the Scottish fish and seafood. Scotland exported fish and seafood is worth over £438 million to EU countries last year, and that represents nearly two-thirds of our food exports. The fishing industry and the ease of market access is of huge importance to Scotland. As with the farming sector, one of the crucial issues here in relation to our exit from the European Union is the protection of the right of EU nationals to continue to live and work here. These individuals make up a large proportion of the workforce in the processing sector. If we were to lose part of our processing capacity in Scotland because of labour shortages, we'd lose landings, we'd lose exports, we'd lose revenue, and we'd jeopardise hundreds of local jobs. And of course, a raw deal for Scotland's fishermen will have a domino effect across all sectors, which are key to the rural economy. For example, in my own region, where the food and drink sector is so important to the livelihood of many, we have renowned seafood restaurants. Scotland's seafood sector is one of our greatest strengths and has built its reputation on a product renowned to the world over for its pristine quality. Scotland is strategically placed to have the best fishing industry in Europe.
Come to a close, please, Ms. Harper.
And I encourage the Scottish Government to be committed to doing all it can to make that a reality. I hope all parties in the Scottish Parliament will today support the Scottish Government's effort to achieve the best possible outcome for Scotland's fishermen. Thank you.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call Tavish Scott. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr. Scott.
Deputy Presiding Officer, well, at least we now know what Stuart Stevenson's here for. He's here to provide backup for colleagues across the chamber when they're working out the intricacies of member state representation at the European level. I'm also very grateful to Gail Ross for giving us the birthday cake analogy. Probably the best illustration, actually, of fishing policy. It hasn't really changed much in those years since that was first written. The best illustration of the reality of what that is. But it does give me a chance just to say a couple of things about my own part of the world in terms of Shetland. We tend to play around for who's got the most fisheries-dependent community and who's the top port, if I can say to others who represent Peterhead in one capacity or another. The reason that Lerwick describes itself as a top port when it comes to fishing landings is it is on a map. I can't remember which chairman of the Port Authority many years thought of that, but heaven forbid we've dined on it, out on it for years ever since. More seriously, I want to say a couple of things about two boats, because just this week, Lowry Irvine, his crew and shareholders launched a new Antares, which will ply the seas in the coming years, a magnificent new vessel for the Scottish pelagic industry, and certainly for Wolsey, it is quite an addition to the fleet. And earlier this year, a young crew, whitefish crew, took the Resilient to sea in our coastal waters, in the island's coastal waters, a very strong sign of encouraging investment for the future. I also wanted just to briefly reflect the point that the Cabinet Secretary made right in his opening remarks about Peterhead and the grant assistance that the government have applied to that particular port. He might want to just clarify in his wind-up too that not only, of course, Peterhead, but many other ports have benefited in the past from that particular EU funding stream. Many hope to do in the future, even in the period that is left until whatever happens with Brexit happens. Certainly, Lerwick have very strong aspirations around a new fish market. The irony of ironies, of course, is that was to be built to EU standard. We don't even know what that'll mean in a few years' time. But the point is more important, that those grants that have helped shoreside facilities, and many members have mentioned the processing industry here this afternoon, and rightly so, are important investments for those businesses. And if the Minister could clarify that, indeed would be helpful. I also want to mention the North Atlantic Fisheries College in Scalloway, because of the science work that goes on there and has gone on there for many years. Dr. Ian Napier published a report which got not just national but international attention just a month or so ago in reporting the scale of landings from EU waters, in other words, in this context, Scottish and waters further to the south that are taken by foreign fishing boats. The definition of foreign is being other EU nationals in this context. And it is important that analysis is going on. That analysis happens because of the scientific weight of places like the NFC Marine Centre in Scalloway. I want to recognise that here as well today. Can I pick up a few points that have been made? Firstly, on that processing industry, John Finney made a fair intervention earlier on about the importance, and Emma Harper's just rightly mentioned it, about the importance of EU citizens. Of course, it's not just our boats that rely on people from different nations, not just EU nations, but nations from further afield as well, but it's also the processing industry. And Emma Harper and John Finney, by inference, were quite right to point out that our processing industry would really struggle were those people not in the industry. And it is important, it is actually really important that that is clarified as a matter of some urgency. I have this hope, and gosh, it's probably only a hope, that now, and tonight in the House of Commons, the Commons will vote for an amendment on a Labour motion, which will mean the UK government have to publish a plan on Brexit. That's a good thing. I hope it not only does it deal with fishing, but it also deals to some extent, when the plan is published, of course, it also deals with this point about EU nationals as well. And I know Ross Thompson was in full rhetorical mode there, as he always is, what he and his colleagues also need to recognise is that the fishing industry also need access to single markets. The Conservative benches need to, and maybe in the wind-up they'll cover this, but the Conservative members need to make clear that is what they want to see as well, because that single market is essential for the processing sector of the Scottish fishing industry. Much of our whitefish, the great majority of our whitefish, and members who represent constituencies in the north of Scotland have been eloquent on this point, goes to Boulogne and other fisheries markets across France and in other European nations, and that single market in that sense is intensely important to that industry, no matter how, again, the shake-up of Brexit happens. Liam Kerr made some good points about what the industry has done on mesh sizes, on square mesh panels. Some of us have been around here a long time, remember debates on square mesh panels lasting whole afternoons, I kid you not, and on other such things as real-time closures. But Mr. Kerr's point was proper, and that is that the industry has done a lot, and that does need to be reflected in what happens in the future and in the demands that are placed upon it. One final point on Brexit. In the Fishing News just the other day, Andrew Oliver, who is a Hull-based solicitor, wrote a pretty informative version of what will need to happen in terms of the Member State and our own government here in Scotland having fisheries law and, more to the point, enshrining it in new law here in Scotland. Mr. Oliver suggests that this could take 20 years. So for all who say that this is instant, easy, and in fairness, a few do say that, but for those who try to say this is all instant, easy, and incredibly straightforward, read this article about the reality of transposing fishing legislation that has been built up over many, many years into Scots law, into our own domestic legislation. It will not be a straightforward process. And that's why today, again, I'm asking the Cabinet Secretary to take forward fisheries plans for the future, because this work has to be done and it has to be got on with. Thank you.
I now call David Stewart. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I believe this has been an important and mainly constructive debate with well-informed and insightful contributions from across the Chamber. As a sign of our cross-party working on this important issue, Labour will be supporting the government motion and the two amendments. And as we've heard previously, Presiding Officer, the 12th of December marks the annual EU quota negotiations in Brussels. And of course, the livelihood of our fishermen are dependent on the outcome of the talks. The 28 fishing ministers of the EU states will, of course, be involved in frenetic talks and in compromises and in amendments and late night, bleary eyed sessions in Brussels. And whether this imperfect system is the best way of managing and sustaining our fisheries is debatable. A point made by Bertie Armstrong, the Chief Exec of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, in Tuesday Scotsman. And like others, I welcome Mr. Armstrong and his colleagues to the gallery this afternoon. However, no one can argue that there is an easy path to balancing the technical, scientific advice with the social economic impact on our fishing communities. And Dr. Stephen Mackinson, who's the Chief Scientific Officer of the Scottish Pelagic Fishermen's Association is teaming up with scientists and fishermen to work out the size of fish stocks using, among other tools, fishing vessels, echo sounders to measure fish abundance. He said that this approach, and I quote, Presiding Officer, helps foster mutual respect between fishermen and scientists, which can only bode well for the future management of our precious fisheries in the 21st century. This is, I believe, a very important debate, given that, as we've heard, Scotland is a key player among Europe's fishing nations and accounts for around two-thirds of the total fish caught in the UK. And given the fact that nearly 5,000 fishermen are employed in Scottish-based vessels, this is a key economic resource for Scotland generally and for the Highlands and Islands and the North East specifically. But the big picture, Presiding Officer, we have a world with global food shortage, while on our doorstep we have fresh, affordable and varied food stock for both domestic and, crucially, the European markets. And Richard Lockhead, who is in the chamber, said in February this year that the fish dumped in the North Sea last year is enough to feed Macedonia, Slovenia and Botswana, while we all know that thousands, indeed millions, are perhaps starving in the developing world. But looking at local level, it's clearly in the local communities that our hard-working fishermen are providing the backbone of the fishing industry. And as a long-time representative of the Highlands and Islands, I'm well aware of the distinctive traditions, the customs and the close-knit communities that the pursuit of fishing has created along the coasts of Scotland. Now, although the majority of the fishing industry now operates from major harbours with large, efficient fleets, we should not forget about the small coastal communities whose residents have lived with the salt of their sea in their blood for generations. I thought this was a very good debate. My colleague Fergus Ewing, I think, had a very insightful speech and mentioned particularly, rather to my shock, that he was being a radical. I've known Mr. Ewing for many years and I could describe him in lots of ways. Radical was perhaps not the word that jumped to my mind, but I believe tonight he will be radical and will support Labour's amendment at 5 o'clock. I can always live in hope, Presiding Officer, if nothing else. He made some, I think, very useful points, particularly about the key issue about good scientific advice must be turned into quotas. Again, I think Peter Chapman spoke very well on a very thoughtful speech, particularly highlighting Peterhead and Fraserburgh as crucially important harbours. And also, I think, a very interesting point he made about fishermen moving to a more sustainable fishing methods. And the key for the future, irrespective of our views on Brexit, is that innovation is the king. And I totally agree with Mr. Chapman on that. My colleague, Rhoda Grant, made the interesting point, of course, that we are still in the EU, and let's not forget that. We haven't yet recorded Article 50, and we will be debating this for many years to come under different, perhaps, models. She mentioned, which is summed up in our amendment, the key issue about marine protection vessels and the point about the £5,000 per year retention bonus being reduced by half. And I think there's a good trade union and Labour generally, and use that in the widest possible term, that we should be supporting. And I would ask colleagues across the chamber if they would consider supporting that point today. Tavish Scott's obviously a member with tremendous experience in fishing for many, many years and made a very strong criticisms about discard, which I agree with. But I think his key point was looking to stability and ability to plan in the future. And I apologise to other members I'm not able to mention because I'm conscious, Presiding Officer, of time. I think you could argue in this debate that Brexit is the ghost at the...
Excuse my interrupting, but you can have a little more time if you would like to, Mr. Scott.
Thank you. I used the next 40-minute speech that I had ready for this occasion. But you could argue, of course, that Brexit is the ghost at the feast in this debate. And although I don't have time to discuss, Brexit in detail, one of the, of course, founding principles of the Common Fisheries Policy was equal access to waters. And as Andrew Oliver, which I think Tavish Stock quoted, a lawyer writing the Fishing and News in July this year, explained, the EU will fall on its obligations under the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Seas as a result of Brexit. As members will be aware, this is an international convention which is unrelated to EU membership and defines the responsibilities of nations on the use of the world's oceans and gives us guidelines for the management of marine resources. Having said that, Presiding Officer, having full access to the European Maritime and Fisheries Fund for the Scottish fishing industry is absolutely crucial. The total budget, as the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, was around €107 million. And the Chancellor said on the 13th of August, I am confirming that structure and investment fund projects signed before the autumn statement and Horizon Research funding granted before we leave the EU will be guaranteed by the Treasury after we leave. However, Marine Scotland, as the Cabinet Secretary is aware, the Scotland's lead agency for fisheries, has set an early final date spend for EMFF projects. Can the Cabinet Secretary in his wind-up confirm, is this still the case? Has it been conveyed to fishermen? And is he confident that we will be able to spend this entire budget, which in my view is vital for the industry? So in Scotland, our fishing communities often exist in a fragile balance with onshore and offshore livelihoods at stake, requiring any significant changes to be viewed with a careful and critical eye. So when looking towards the future of the industry, we know that sustainable development of fisheries is beneficial environmentally, socially, and economically, but we still must proceed with caution. Our fishermen are some of the most resilient workers in the whole of Scotland. Whether the adversity they face stems from the high seas or from EU regulations, Scottish fishermen will rise to the challenge.
I now call on Finlay Carson, around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to close for the Scottish Conservatives. I want to start by thanking members on all sides of the Chamber for their contribution this afternoon. It's been generally a consensual debate, and as my colleague Liam Kerr said, it's put Scotland's fishing industry at the centre of our national discourse. In terms of GDP, although the industry is only worth a small percentage of the Scottish economy, it is the lifeblood of many local communities. Last year, over 4,800 fishermen were employed on Scottish registered vessels, and there was a welcome increase in the number of active fishing vessels registered in Scotland. Since taking up my role, I've met with many fishermen, industry leaders and processors, and I've visited the leading scallop port and businesses in Kirkcudbright and the Peterhead Fish Market to witness the slick market operation and see some of Scotland's finest catch. And on that note, I'm sure I and all of my colleagues from this side of the chamber welcome the Cabinet Secretary's announcement, albeit long awaited, the £5 million to modernise and enhance the Peterhead Port, Europe's largest fishing port. Like many colleagues, I want to pay tribute to those who work in our fishing industry, an industry which has played a huge part in the culture of Scotland, often with a lack of recognition of not only the economic impact, but the social impact on the very fabric of our rural coastal communities. Sadly, the importance of fishing communities is often only seen when tragedy strikes, and I have personal experience of the devastation felt by fishing communities when a boat fails to return to port, like the Mariel or the Solway Harvester in my hometown of Kirkcudbright. Fishermen work in the most treacherous conditions, but have never been afraid to rise to the challenge, whether it be in stock management or getting their heads around the often complicated regulations that flow from Brussels. Presiding Officer, it seems likely that the final agreement at next week's meeting will be a mixed bag for Scottish fishermen. The Scottish Fishermen's Federation have already voiced concerns at the proposed whiting catch arrangement. This agreement has already alluded to and will see increased access for Norway to the Scottish fishing waters, enabling them to catch 68% of the blue whiting catch allocated to the west of the British Isles, and at the same time as benefiting from an additional transfer of 110,000 tonnes of EU blue whiting. This is disappointing news for the Scottish fleet, who landed over 30,000 tonnes of blue whiting last year with a value of over £6 million. But the disappointment is not simply that these arrangements will mean that they're not able to catch the same next year. The bargaining of blue whiting is merely a symptom of the uneasy compromise that defines these annual negotiations. Under the whiting arrangement, Norway will hugely benefit from Scotland's fishing waters, while countries such as France and Portugal will benefit from the EU's sign-off from this trade-off. This is quite literally a prime example of the EU selling Scottish fishing waters down the river. According to a report by the University of Highlands and Islands, more than half of the fish and shellfish caught in the UK's EEZ is caught by fishermen from other EU countries. What other country would give away half its natural resource? It's not normal, and quite frankly, it needs rebalanced. With Brexit, we have a perfect opportunity to do just that.
Richard Lochhead.
Can I thank the member for giving way? If leaving the CFP is seen as the silver lining in the Brexit cloud, do the Conservatives recognise that for the wider seafood sector, ongoing membership of the single market is essential, and therefore the UK government should back Scotland's call to ensure that's delivered for Scotland's industries, and particularly our seafood sector, who export two-thirds of their product to Europe?
Finlay Carson.
I think everybody on this side of the chamber will agree that we need to do everything we possibly can to ensure that these markets they will have, both in the UK and in Europe and the rest of the world, are protected. And we'll do everything we can do to ensure that these negotiations reach that outcome. I welcome the comments from the Cabinet Secretary that he wished to see the end of the days where boats are tied up and quota still available. And the discard regulations need to be looked at the same time as the advances in net technology, which are led by our very own Scottish fishermen. Rhoda Grant, we will be supporting our amendment because Marine Scotland have a critical and crucial role to play in enforcing the regulations, and the government need to ensure that Marine Scotland is fit for purpose to protect and ensure sustainability of our fish and shellfish stocks. Tavish Scott talked a lot of sense, and I share much of his concerns. However, we won't be supporting his motion, including a call for Scottish fisheries policies irrespective of the Brexit outcome. Beg your pardon, it must be tea time. That's it. Talking of fish suppers, we were treated as normal to a real fish supper rather than a dog's dinner from Stuart Stevenson. Over the dog's dinner that the fishing policy has been in the past. And I welcome him echoing the call for one voice. Indeed, we need to look at the history and the mistakes made in the past to ensure that they're not repeated in the future. Marie Todd and I agree how important fishing is to our coastal rural constituencies and her call for the balanced fisheries management, which was also echoed by Claudia Beamish. John Finney played the green card, and I agree that science and good science needs to be continued to be used. And John Scott's helpful intervention highlighted the difficult relationship currently in existence between commercial and environmental bodies in our MPA designated waters. And we need to find a solution to sustainable fisheries. And Kate Forbes also touched on the importance of research and technology. Gail Ross was rather flummoxed after Ross Thompson's contribution. And her cake, although not a fish cake, was the basis of her contribution. But in this great British bake-off, Ross Thompson definitely came out as the winner. Emma Harper, unfortunately, couldn't resist the Westminster bashing and rather forgot that today it's the EU that is currently the problem with our fisheries. And once again, I was glad to see Mr. Stevenson come to her rescue as she appeared to be a fish out of water. Dave Stewart gave a very balanced contribution, looking not only at the economics, but also the socio-economic importance of fishing in our small coastal communities. Ross Thompson, in his contribution, spoke about the possibilities and opportunities that Brexit presents for our fishing industry. As he said, the biggest prize will be the control of our waters so that UK fishing interests can be directly represented at the negotiation table by the UK, not the EU, who, as next week's agreements will demonstrate, appear to buckle to the demands of other countries such as Norway at the expense of our hard-working Scottish fishermen. At such an important juncture for our fishing industry, the Scottish Government have a choice to make. So far in this series of Brexit debates, the SNP have chosen to advance an agenda of gripe and grievance at every opportunity. But we've urged these benches to get round the table and work with the UK government to secure the best deal for Scotland. Today, I make that plea to the Minister again. I was delighted that he acknowledged in his contribution that we need to look at Brexit as an opportunity and not an excuse to bash Westminster at every opportunity. These prizes on offer for Scotland's fishing industry are huge. Securing them would reaffirm Scotland's reputation as a supplier of high-quality, sustainable seafood. The interests of Scottish and UK fishermen should always be at the forefront of future negotiations. In closing, presiding officer,
I think you have to close.
On behalf
please,
of the Scottish Conservatives, I wish to wish George Eustace, our Cabinet Secretary, and the Scottish fishing industry representatives from Scotland every success in next week's negotiations in Brussels.
Thank you, Mr. Carson. I hope you enjoy your tea when you finally get there. I now call Fergus Ewing up to about a minute to five, please, Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. During this debate, I learned the very sad news that Alex Johnson, MSP, has passed away. Were he here, he would have been a very jovial and reasoned presence. And he was a doughty fighter for the northeast of Scotland. So we will miss him. Especially of us old lags, presiding officer, that have been around since the class of 99. So we pass on our thoughts to Linda and his family. I want to start on a positive note on the substance of the debate, which is that after listening to the arguments presented by Labour, Conservative and Liberals, and despite some efforts to prevent me from agreeing to support their motion from time to time, I'm happy to say that the Scottish Government will, with some reservations as to the wording and some technical aspects of each of the three amendments, be supporting them. And the reason we're doing that, I think, is that it is important to demonstrate to the fishing communities that other than some different views and perspective, we are essentially all behind them in securing the best deal in the negotiations. And that has been, I think, the way of it in these debates over the years. We all respect the science, the stock sustainability, the importance of that, as John Finney pointed out, particularly today in the debate. We support the protection of the economic well-being of our industry and the contribution they make to rural communities, as Kate Forbes alluded to in respect of Mallig. And we pursue our commitment to achieving discard-free fisheries. And John Scott made a telling intervention right at the start of this debate. So, you know, separating out some of the other points and the political mist that descended upon us from time to time over the debate, I thought I'd start off with that, what I hope is a consensual note that we will be... Well, certainly to Mr. Rumbles.
On that consensual...
Mike Rumbles.
I'm very glad that he's accepting the Liberal Democrat amendment, which calls for a plan for fisheries. When do you think the minister will be able to outline to Parliament when he thinks his views about how fisheries in Scotland should operate once we leave the European Parliament? When do you think he'll be in a position to outline that?
Fergus Ewing.
I'm happy to. Set out the principles which I think would apply, and I don't actually think there would be much that would divide us in setting out principles which underlie that approach. So I don't think that's a particular challenge. I'm happy to do it, but with respect, I would say that the real purpose of this debate, Presiding Officer, is whilst I support the sentiment in that part of the amendment of Mr. Scott, the real purpose of this debate is to look at the particular task that faces us, and we are still in the EU, of getting the best possible deal for Scotland in the circumstances. And I think that was a task which, by and large, most members applied themselves. And of course, there are many important aspects at the moment where the EU does make a positive contribution, and reference has been made to by Mr. Stewart to the EMFF, and I think Claudia Beamish as well, and various other members. Mr. Mountain, I think, mentioned it as well. And I was pleased to formally announce the £5 million provision to a £49 million project for major upgrades to Peterhead. This is really a very, very practical contribution, because I saw for myself on Monday that the existing market in Peterhead is absolutely packed and full. So the boxes are three high. That means the buyers can only really expected to take on trust what lies in the bottom box, because it's quite impossible with auctions taking place every 30 seconds to do more than have a cursory glance at the top two. So the space needed and the money given is very well used and much needed. And there has been £77 million of over 1,200 projects safeguarding 8,000 jobs from the EMFF. This is not a minor provision. This has been part of a strategic support for the fishing industry funded from the EU. And moreover, as Mr Stewart pointed out, between now, 2014 and 2020, the seafood and marine sectors will receive €107 million in direct assistance supporting research, development and structural reform. And yes, you know, I confirm that we will, of course, and we are applying ourselves to utilising that to the maximum. It's not often governments underspend their budgets, I have to say, in my experience at any rate. But the point is that this fund makes a massive contribution to the fishing sector. And I think it's reasonable then to say, and I don't expect an answer today, that's not reasonable, but it's reasonable to say, what will replace the EMFF? If there were to be Brexit, what has the UK government said about the support for food and fisheries? Support not at a nugatory level, but a very substantial level indeed. And in that regard, I was very pleased to spend Sunday evening in the company, amongst others, of Jimmy Buchan, the TV skipper and great company. And I mentioned Jimmy because, as well as consuming some of his fish from the Amity, actually on the menu at the Buchan Braised Hotel, which I commend to everybody, incidentally, excellent meal with Jimmy Buchan's food on the menu. But he has also devised a separator net which separates out and allows juvenile fish to escape. And this innovation is, I think, one of the ones that was mentioned, I think, by Mr. Kerr, as important in the fishing industry, and it's fishermen themselves that are coming up with innovative ideas. Have a look at Jimmy Buchan's separator net on the YouTube, if you wish. So these efforts are pursued, are assisted by EU money. Now, also, yes, of course I will, yes.
Liam MacArthur.
Thanks, Fergus Union, for taking an intervention. If I could take them from the east to the west coast, and certainly there's been efforts there in terms of technical measures as well. But the bycatch rules are causing real problems, I think particularly in terms of the targeted monk and saithe fisheries because of the bycatch of cod. Like his reasonable suggestion, the Tories, I wouldn't expect an immediate response now, but will he undertake to look specifically at that issue and see how it might be resolved?
Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I'm aware of that issue and I'm happy to confirm that we will continue to look at it. But the EU is also important, as was pointed out by Richard Lockhead, my predecessor, in a most telling intervention, that the EU is a market, and it's the largest food export market for Scottish fish, and amounts to £438 million, and nearly two-thirds of the total value of food exports to the European Union, and access to a common market of over 500 million people. And I was pleased to hear Mr. Carson give what seemed to be an unqualified support for the importance of continued access to this market on an unqualified basis. If that is the Conservative policy, I think we've seen some progress made in this debate. I'm happy to hear from Mr. Carson if I've misstated him in any way. But that was a most welcome clarification from the Conservatives that they are unequivocally in favour of continuance of membership of the free market. We did not get clarification response to Mr. Finney. He's not intervening. Moving on, we did not get clarification about the counterpart measure raised by many members, namely that for the fishing sector, just as the farming sector, just as the tourism sector, just as the forestry sector, and every other part of the rural economy, people that work in Scotland who are from other parts of Europe, and who are most welcome to do so, as far as we are concerned, are an essential part of the capacity of the fish processing sector. This point was made by a great many members. I don't think it was made by any Conservative members. Maybe that was just an omission. But it is the truth. So sooner or later, I think we do need absolute clarity from the UK government so that we can put this unfortunate issue to rest. I know this is causing huge concern, and I met a lady after a constituency surgery in a hotel in my constituency who hailed from a European country, and she said if there was no clarity soon, she would have to consider marriage as the final option. I don't think the point was directed to me in particular. It was more of a general proposition. So in conclusion, returning to fish, presiding officer, I'm delighted that we will all unite behind the efforts that will be made next week by those who are arguing in Brussels at length for the best possible deal for the Scottish fishing industry, and I'm very pleased that all members will unite behind that cause this evening.
Thank you, and that concludes our debate. Before we take the next item of parliamentary business, I'm afraid I have to bring some very sad news, and that is to inform the Chamber that our parliamentary colleague Alex Johnson has died. I know that all of us who had the good fortune to have known Alex over many years will be very saddened and touched to hear of his death. There will be an opportunity for Parliament and for MSPs to express our sympathy and our condolences, but I also know that on behalf of all of us, we'd like his family to know that we are thinking of them at this difficult time. The Parliament will now consider a business motion 2953 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 2953.
Moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak. I put the question to the Chamber. The question is that we agree motion 2953 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move on block motions 2954 and 2955 on the approval of SSIs.
Moved on block.
Thank you. The question comes at decision time, to which we now come. The first question is that Amendment 2922.1 in the name of Peter Chapman, which seeks to amend Motion 2922 in the name of Fergus Ewing on sea fisheries and NGO negotiations, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that Amendment 2922.2 in the name of Rhoda Grant, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Fergus Ewing, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that Amendment 2922.3 in the name of Tavish Scott, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Fergus Ewing, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 2922.3 in the name of Tavish Scott is yes 85, no 0. There were 30 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 2922 in the name of Fergus Ewing, as amended, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 2922 in the name of Fergus Ewing as amended is yes 83, no 30. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 2954 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed? The final question is that motion 2955 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. That concludes decision time, and we'll now move to members' business in the name of George Adam on Paisley City of Culture, and we'll just take a few moments to change seats.